When Kublai Khan finally received word about the disastrous first invasion, he would attempt to send troops to Korea to prepare for a second, but he would rescind the order as this was when his armies were in their final push to the Song's southern capital shown earlier. The great Khan therefore must have realized focusing his eastern military efforts on the Song's capital was the more prudent plan. This would provide the Japanese with 7 years of intervening peace, but they would regardless make preparations for what they likely knew was a delayed but incoming storm. They would make preparations both of a physical, defensive nature, but also based on their perceptions of events, religious ones as well. The physical preparations included the construction of a long defensive wall along the shore of Hakata Bay. The length close to 20 kilometers in its entirety east to west. It was built in most places roughly 50 meters from the shore and meant to hold the Mongols at bay to provide enough time for countermeasures. Those who displayed cowardice during the first invasion were dealt with, and heroes displaying valor and courage were rewarded. A new round of recruitment for samurai was also initiated in 1276, one that was irrespective of their vassal status. They had also planned to preemptively raid Korea, but did not end up committing the resources. They did not bolster the defenses on Iki or Tsushima, however, indicating their acceptance of both likely being overrun and their confidence being placed instead on the potential beachhead again at Hakata Bay. In 1277, they learned of the defeat of the Southern Song and must have known the Mongols would once again cast an eye towards their shores. In 1279, the Khan would send yet another last-ditch envoy attempt, but like their predecessors, they too were executed upon landing on Japanese shores. The following year, in 1280, he would summon a top-level conference at one of his summer palaces to discuss the strategy for the second invasion. Having learned lessons from the first, it was clear this one would be of a much larger scale. The wreckage of Mongol ships that were found contained farming implements on them, indicating the Mongols were prepared for a permanent, long-term occupation of Japan. Also different was this attack would be two-pronged, one fleet from Korea as before, and a second, this time, from southern China. It's clear that these were still not always the best soldiers, as those were likely engaged elsewhere in the empire, as records show that prisoners were given commuted sentences to serve in the second invasion. And despite the contribution from southern China, Korea would again bear a disproportionate portion of the burden. While 600 warships were commissioned from the Chinese, the Koreans had to prepare 900. Again, troop estimates were prone to exaggeration and either under or overestimated, depending on which side tells the account. Best estimates are an army roughly three times the size of the Mongol force from 1274, and the Japanese also likely much larger than the defensive force from the previous attempt. The order from the Khan to attack Japan was given on the first lunar month in the year 1281. The eastern assault from Korea would be carried out similarly to the first invasion. The Chinese fleet, consisting of the south of the Yangtze force, would sail across 768 kilometers of ocean to meet up with the eastern forces and then combine near the island of Iki for a single massive attack. The Mongol military general Arakan was given supreme command of the invading forces, and he would travel with the southern fleet. The eastern route Mongol army from Korea set sail on the 22nd of May 1281, but took longer than the first fleet in 1274 to arrive at Tsushima, arriving on the 9th of June. Without recorded reinforcement and resigned to the same fate of his late father, So Moriaki, son of Skesada, would meet the overwhelming Mongol landing party and die. 300 islanders would be killed, and of these, some had taken children and women to hide in the mountains, but Mongol patrols found these too and slaughtered them. What forces the Japanese did have on the islands were on Iki, which the Mongols breached on the 14th of June. A Japanese army under the command of Shoni Sketoki and Yuzo Sketoki said to have been in the low thousands to meet the Mongols on the western Iki beaches, where they were routed and killed. The Mongols were to have waited for the southern army to arrive, but for some unrecorded reason they did not, attacking both islands immediately instead. It's likely that spies from China provided intelligence on the wall defense at Hakata. Even after Iki, the Mongol Eastern Fleet did not wait for the south to join them, instead splitting their Eastern Fleet in two, one to attack Hakata, and the other to head east and attack Nagato at the tip of Honshu. This occurred on the 25th of June, but details are scarce. We do know that there's no recorded damage, only rumors that the fleet had been seen. The Eastern Fleet half that was to land at Hakata Bay did not have the anticipated element of surprise. The Japanese had not only manned sections of the wall with archers, but breaking with tradition, had received direct orders to fully cooperate as a whole. Mongol crafts that made attempts to land on the shores were met with volleys of arrows from archers hidden behind the walls where they could not return fire. While the Mongols did not likely incur heavy casualties, they did make a decision to delay landing for now and instead take possession of the two bay islands of Shiga and Noko. Although Shiga Island was really more of a peninsula in that it was connected by a thin strip of sandbar to the mainland. The Japanese, though, rather than sit back, would take the fight to the Mongol ships that laid anchor. They attacked via the sandbar on foot, but their most successful tactic was one of utilizing a large number of smaller vessels to attack the much larger ocean-going Mongol fleet. The masts of the small ships providing makeshift bridges by which to climb on board the Mongol vessels. Some samurai were said to have swam over to the Mongol ships to attack. We know that those successful boarding attempts resulted in the taking of Mongol heads for future reward. Ultimately, it would be the success, though, of the little ship raids that would pay the largest dividend for the Japanese against their invader foe. Finally, on the 7th lunar month in July, the southern fleet arrived. Plans between them would be fleshed out over the course of July and would result in a new target, the island of Takashima, roughly 50 kilometers further west of Hakata Bay. On the 12th of August, as the Mongol fleet neared Takashima, the Japanese little ship fleets were there to meet them. Fighting initiated almost immediately, and it raged on through the night for many bloody hours. While details of the storms said to have assisted the Japanese during the first invasion are suspect, there is definitive archaeological evidence for a great storm assisting them during the second. As the ship battles raged on for days, with the Mongols not able to make any landing attempts, and the Japanese likely being mostly fended off in the more open water, neither side could make much headway. At some point later in the month of August, which is midway during typhoon season, a storm came rolling in. As it neared, it intensified in its ferocity. It was recorded that ships near the shore collided with each other, snapping free or flailing about at the end of their anchor ropes. Men were washed overboard and drowned or dashed against the rocky shores nearby. Those in the deeper waters cut anchor to try to ride out the storm. The sound of splitting timber must have rivaled that of the storm claps itself. We don't have exact numbers for the loss of life, but a Korean source says that of the 27,000 Koreans sent on the eastern route, 7,500 did not return, indicating a casualty rate of roughly 30%. It's interesting in that the Chinese and Mongol sources indicate a casualty rate of 60 to 90. Was this perhaps to save face? Again, speculation, as we don't have definitive evidence. Those boats that had cut free would make their way back to China and Korea, abandoning any survivors who managed to wash up on the shores to their fate. And their fate being slaughter at the hands of the Japanese, who carefully rounded the shorelines and the waters in vessels, killing any and all survivors. Some sources say, though, that the Song Chinese, whom the Japanese felt were coerced into joining the attack on Japan, were spared. But even their fate would be that of slaves. Speculation on the discrepancy between the Korean and Mongol Chinese estimates rages on to this day, with some feeling that the Eastern Fleet was more battle-hardened, but again, we don't have definitive evidence. A third attempt was tossed around, but soon the Khan would be embroiled in a series of frontier battles, and the invasion of Japan would fade into history. But not in Japan. There it would become a source of national pride, and a sort of divinity cult would arise around the kamikaze, which they would call the Great Typhoon that struck the Mongol fleet. And here ends the Mongol invasions of Japan. Hopefully you enjoyed it. If you did, please hit that like button. If you haven't yet and enjoy the content on this channel, consider subscribing. I'd love to have you on board. And as always, until the next video, cheers.